Well, hey, everybody, welcome into this Photoshop tutorial brought to you, as always, by tutvid.com. Today, we're going to take a look at five different techniques for getting rid of basically anything from basically any photo right here in Photoshop. Now, before we actually jump into it, I want to give a quick shout out to my brand new sponsor today, my good friends over at skillshare.com. They like what we've got going on over here. I like what they got going on over there, quite frankly. And it's just a great place where you can go and learn how to do all kinds of amazing stuff as an artist, a creator, business person, marketer, you name it. Most importantly here, if you're one of the first 150 people to sign up using the link in the description, you're going to get 2 months of Skillshare for free. And last I checked, free doesn't cost anything, so you might want to check it out. Speaking of checking stuff out, let's jump into this tutorial and check this thing out. All right, here we are in Photoshop. I want to take a look at the first method, and that is using the patch tool. The idea is going to be get rid of this guy in this photo. It's a complex background behind him, and he takes up a lot of the photo, quite frankly. So let's see what we can do with the patch tool. Will it be perfect? Probably not, but I think you'll be surprised at just how good it can be. Now, when I'm using the patch tool, which, by the way, it's located beneath the spot healing and healing brushes right there, patch tool, I tend to just like to work with content aware. It's a really great mode for working with this tool. Now, structure has to do with how much of the source structure is preserved when you are adjusting your image or getting rid of something. Now, the general rule that I like to follow is the bigger the selection or the bigger area that I'm getting rid of, I want the structure to be high. So when I get rid of the bulk of this dude, the structure is going to be up to 7. But if I was just like selecting this little leaf and getting rid of that, I would probably go ahead and set the structure to like 1. Color has to do with how much Photoshop can edit the colors that it's working with, just, you know, to speak in very layman's terms here. So let's leave the structure at 7, and we'll create a quick selection around our subject here. There we go, something like that, and I will just drag this over, and don't worry if we have some of him left there. You can see him hanging out on the left-hand side. We want to just get rid of the bulk of this, and I'm just watching where the dirt on the ground is. Give it a second. It's a big image here that I'm working with. I'm just watching where sort of the ground plane is, because I know that's going to have to be adjusted a little bit. Command or Control D to deselect, and look at how that's pretty good. Let's reduce our structure to about 4 or so and try to get rid of this big mess over here. Right, so we'll take this, and what we'll do is we'll just get some of the grass from over here, and I'm just watching, again, where the dirt mound is going to be, and just make sure it kind of lines up with the rest of the dirt, and then I'll Command or Control D to deselect. We still have some ghosting and some blurriness, so maybe I'll select this and just move this grassiness over. Command or Control D to deselect. And a lot of using something like the patch tool is a matter of just knowing, yeah, I'm gonna go over my image a couple times, especially with something that's a big heel like this. I'll go over it a couple times if I need to, but I'm gonna put myself in a position to succeed by kind of knowing how I'm using the tool. And you can see very, very quickly, we've gone in and gotten rid of this whole entire dude who was taking up a big part of our image. Okay, let's move over to technique number 2. And this one is going to be the straight content aware fill. So here what we've got is a couple. Let's say his name's Jack and Susie, right? But then Jack started getting a little weird. He started espousing some strange beliefs, and he started going on these like nationwide sort of pilgrimage things. And Susie was like, getting a little weird for me. I'm ready to get out of this. But they had these great couple photos together. The problem is Jack's got to go. So Jack, I'm sorry about this, but we got to get rid of you. So the first step would be work on the layer itself. This is a kind of a destructive technique. And then go ahead and loop a lasso selection around your subject. And then what I'll do with the lasso is I'll go through and just get rid of anywhere. You really want the selection to kind of be relatively tight. It doesn't have to be like that tight. You know, something around that is fine. But I may even go in here to like where there's nothing and just, you know, get rid of that. I'm holding down Alt or Option with the lasso tool and just getting rid of these bits of selection. It just makes the job of content aware that much easier and gives you that much of a better result. But just know, if you create a selection and you're not getting great results, you can go select and choose modify and expand or contract your selection by, I don't know, I'll usually go 10 or 15 pixels at a time. So if this doesn't work, I might expand it 10 pixels and so on and so forth. But let's go ahead and just try this. Let's go edit and choose fill. And right here from the contents dropdown, you want to choose content aware and leave color adaptation checked on and just go ahead and hit okay. And then I'll hit Command or Control D to deselect. And you can see just like that, she can go on living her own peaceful life with none of the weirdness. And of course, if you do need to make some changes, you can grab your patch tool like we did before, and you can just go in and just change up the background a little bit to try to hide any kind of irregularities or anything you notice. I think I actually made the background look worse by doing that, so I'll undo that. But you can see, over a background that would be difficult to just go in and clone stamp and make it look realistic, Content Aware Fill literally takes seconds. It takes longer to make the selection. All right, let's stop here for a quick minute. I want to give a quick shout out to Skillshare.com. They help support my channel. So if you're in the market to get smarter and better at the creative stuff you're doing, I'd love for you to check them out. Because whether you're looking to take your side hustle to the next level or master photography, graphic design, videography, or marketing, Well, Skillshare, they've got you covered. They've got over 19,000 courses on a wide variety of topics, from photography, videography, business, and design. I've actually had Skillshare for a little while now, and one of the courses that I loved, I finished the watching, it was like an hour and a half, hour, 37 minutes, something like that, is Logo Design with Draplin, Secrets of Shape, Type, and Color, done by Aaron Draplin. If you haven't seen this guy, you're really missing out. Really cool personality, and he's a really talented graphic designer. I also really like the course Street Photography, Capturing the Life of Your City. That's done by an artist called Trash Hand. It's all about telling stories, finding great shots in your surroundings, and just a whole bunch more in terms of street photography. Skillshare membership, well, it costs about 10 bucks a month, but Skillshare, they gave me the hookup. The first 150 of you that use the link in the description of this video, well, you get 2 months of Skillshare for free, kind of like I mentioned in the open. Please consider checking it out and supporting them for supporting us. Thanks, guys, and let's get back to the tutorial. Okay, and moving on to technique number three. This one is the straight healing brush, and I absolutely love this tool. Not the spot healing brush, it's the second healing brush tool here, the regular old healing brush, and I like to use this non-destructively. So the idea is going to be here with this beach photo, we want to try to get rid of a bunch of the stuff here in the foreground. Maybe let's say we want to clear out all this stuff over here and just make a clear path right through to the beach. In theory, you could go through and clean everything in the image out, but we're working on a little bit of a time budget here, so let's get through this quickly. We're going to get rid of everything over here. Now, to work non-destructively, you simply create a new layer, and we can name this layer something like blemishes. That always works, and I like to set my tool to current and below. What that means is it's going to sample pixels from the current layer and any layers beneath it. So it's going to get stuff from the background, which is exactly what I want. And the way diffusion works is the higher your diffusion number is, sort of the more fadedness there's going to be on the outside edges of the brush. The lower your diffusion is, the more hard-edged the blends on the edge of your brush are going to be. Again, using layman's terms, ignore that little warning dialog box that popped up, just in very layman's terms. Now, the reason that dialog box popped up is because when you're working with this tool, I'm going to zoom in here a little bit. When you're working with this tool, you need to sample before you try to paint. So I'm going to make my brush a little smaller using the square bracket keys, and I'm going to hold down Alt or Option. And the trick with this brush is, let's say we want to get rid of these people here. Well, we wouldn't just simply sample the sand. I'm holding down Alt or Option, and now I just paint over them. You can see that looks pretty horrible, right? What you want to do is identify the edges of high contrast. And right here, the edge of high contrast is, of course, where the sand runs into the sea in this photo. So I'm going to sample right along that edge. And then when I hover over these people, I'm going to try to line that edge back up. See, I get the little preview there. Line that edge back up. And now when I paint over them, I have a beautiful little heel just like that. And I can go out into the ocean at that point and say, you know what, ocean, I actually want this wave moved over here like that and get rid of that wave kind of sort of all together. And this would probably call for making the brush a little smaller as well. And something like this too, you may be better suited having a lower diffusion, but you can see we just got rid of them perfectly like that. And then I could select the edge of the beach here, make my brush a little bit bigger, and I could go ahead and get rid of these towels just like that. And, you know, as I fly through this image here, you can just see I can very, very quickly get rid of people sticking their heads out of the ocean. Even these people here in the foreground, we can get rid of them. There's all kinds of really, really great stuff that we can do here with this healing brush. And one thing you'll notice here is that we do have a lot of like faded, almost artifacts left behind. This would probably be an area where I would reduce diffusion, maybe down to 3 or 4, something like that, and then just begin painting over this stuff. And sometimes the preview looks bad, but the trick is keep painting until it looks good, because sometimes it's a matter of covering up sort of the problem area, if you will. And as soon as you do that, things really clean up and start looking better really, really, really fast. And there we have it. Again, it's a matter of identifying high contrast edges, going in and finessing it a little bit. You can see there's a bit of a repeating shadow here. You could go in with a smaller healing brush and really try to smooth and flatten some of that stuff out. Correct this edge a little bit. Maybe we would paint over that to try to get rid of some of the brightness, or take dodge and burn in there and adjust that a little bit. But the point is, very, very quickly with the healing brush on a separate layer, you can see we took this photo from having all this stuff in it and just got rid of it. So you can imagine if you have a landscape photo with just a single person in there, getting rid of them is going to be relatively easy, because this, we took a lot of stuff out in a very little amount of time. All right, well, on to technique number four, and this is just the good old standard clone stamp tool right here. The clone stamp tool, I'm going to go ahead and set the opacity back to 100, and I'm going to use it pretty much as you see it here, opacity and flow at 100. I'm going to check on aligned, and once more, I'm going to sample current and below, and we're going to create a new layer. The idea is going to be we want to cover up the fireplace, or at least the bulk of it here for this example. The clone stamp tool has so much you can do with it, and there's a really amazing panel that goes along with it called clone source, which we'll take a little look at in a little bit, but you can see it right over here. There's some really powerful features here, including the rotation features of the tool, being able to flip the brush horizontal, vertical, and also changing the size of the clone that you're painting. So that can be really nice if you're sampling from something far away and painting it up close. You can make it much bigger, or vice versa, you can make it much smaller. Basically, all we want to do here is cover the fireplace. Now, we happen to have a beautiful brick pattern right up here, so we can just sample from that. So I know I'm going to begin my clone at the top left corner, so I'm going to look for bricks up here in the top left corner of this, so in theory I can paint the entire thing. And I'm just going to zoom in, and I can see this is the joint that I'm going to target right here. So I would have one brick, two brick, and then the brick that's kind of straddling above them. That's the point which I want to sample. So I'm going to move up here, I'm going to grab my clone stamp tool, I'm going to make sure that the brush head's small enough, so it's a little too big, maybe something like that's good. Maybe I'll make the edges of the brush a little bit harder, so I'll increase the hardness to like 50% or so. By the way, I just right-clicked, ignore that little dialogue, and I'm going to sample right from there. So you can see two bricks coming together and the brick straddling it. I'm going to move back down here. I'm going to line that right up with right there or right about there, and then I can just go ahead and paint. So I can just paint right over this fireplace, and just like that, we can cover the entire fireplace. And you can see just how quickly working with the clone stamp brush can work, even on something that's a more intricate pattern like this. Of course, it's eternally helpful that we have this beautiful pattern from which we can sample. But again, this is just an example of knowing which tool to use for which job. And then, of course, we can go in and mask away to make sure we get our little golden orb ball back and correct the lighting a little bit. It should be a little darker over here on the right side of the fireplace, things like that. But all that can be done after the fact. The point is, we got this fireplace removed from this photo in no time flat. All right, so now we are on to feature function technique number 5, and that's using the clone stamp tool in perspective. This one's pretty cool. To work non-destructively, Command or Control J to duplicate your layer, and we're going to add our vanishing point grid to this layer number 1 here and do all of our sort of cloning up here. Let's go filter and choose vanishing point. Now, here in the vanishing point UI, I'm going to zoom out a little bit. That's just Command or Control and the minus key. I have the grid tool, and I want to draw my grid, so I'm going to go right along the base of the building, right like that. And then I'm going to say, yep, bring this up to about the roof of the building, and then come back across the roof of the building, just sort of like that. Something like that, probably close enough. Now, we want to get the base of our little mudroom appendage here on the side of the building. So I'm going to select the grid middle point, and I'm just going to pull straight down like that. There are a lot of cool things you can do with grids. We're not going to get into all of them here in this tutorial, though. All right, let's zoom in a little bit and focus on the task at hand, and that is getting rid of this bizarre-looking building here. I don't really know why I'm calling it a building, a piece of this building. Let's grab the clone stamp tool here. It's a bit of like a dumbed-down, rudimentary clone stamp tool, but it's cool nonetheless. So what I'm going to do is hold down Alt or Option, and I'm going to select this corner of this window because I know I can exactly line it up with this corner, and hopefully our vertical columns will line up. We may have some trouble with that, but let's give this a shot and see what it looks like. So let's select there, and then I'll come over here, and let's try to line this up perfectly with the window, maybe kind of, sort of, like that. There's going to have to be some blending here. Yeah, and this is going to be, these pillars are going to be a little off. But you can see here, as I go over, we're placing an entire window in place and coming down and placing grass. Now we need to adjust where our stamp is, where our stamp is sampling from, because we're getting more of the roof here. But you can see here that we've gone in and completely made that go away. Of course, we can blend these bricks together afterward. I'm going to really try not to be too concerned with that. I'm going to sample from the same corner here, Alt or Option, get a new sample, line it up with the window that we just sort of installed, if you will. Let's undo. I accidentally started painting. Let me sample again. Alt or Option and click, and there's our sampling point, and right there should work. And we can paint right over this, and you can see, just get right into place where we clone stamp away this entire funky looking whatever doorway appendage thing it is on the side of this building. And in terms of making these bricks and things line up, cleaning up the shadows, all that is going to be relatively easy to do compared to what we had. Now, one thing I do want to point out is you do have a healing option here in this clone stamp tool in vanishing point. I had that shut off because I tend to like to be able to heal up and clean stuff up later on my own, but just know you have the power and the ability to do that. Now, it doesn't look looks kind of horrible, but it doesn't look that bad like this, considering the fact that we began with that, and in a mere 2-3 minutes, whatever it was, we got rid of it, and all we have left to do is blend some shadows and texture together. It's really, really nice. We can lighten up the grass, you know, clone some stuff in along there, but essentially we can go and make that renovation to this building very, very quickly using the clone stamp tool in perspective. Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. That's it. Those are the five techniques and kind of that one finished image there to top it all off in the end. If you enjoyed it, I would appreciate it if you would subscribe to this channel so you never miss any Photoshop or other graphic design or photography related tutorials in the future. Also, if you're on Instagram, check me out on Instagram at tutvid. There's like a whole different side of me that you get over there in terms of seeing a little behind the scenes stuff. We try to do some fun stuff over there and keep things interesting, so to speak. So for everything we covered here in this tutorial today, from the patch tool to content-aware fill and content-aware this, that, and the other, the healing brush, making a tree, for crying out loud, are you kidding me? Ladies and gentlemen, for all that and everything else we covered in this tutorial, that's it. Get it, got it, good. Nathaniel Dodson, tutvid.com. I'll catch you in the next one. And before you go, make sure you subscribe to my channel for more great tutorials every day. Also, buy my course. It helps us do what we do, and this channel is supported by viewers just like you. You can also just click the thumbnail and watch another video from this channel. See you next time, guys.